Hey, Free to Code Camp, and welcome to another The Daily Programmer web series video. And in this video, we're going to talk about a problem called Spiral Ascension, which is number 320. So let's go ahead and look at the problem and read it on the subreddit. All right, so this is the problem that we're going to be solving in this video. It's challenge number 320. It's called Spiral Ascension. And I'll go ahead and just read it off. It says, the user enters a number, make a spiral that begins with 1 and starts from the top left, going towards the right, and ends with a square of that number. So some examples they give you is a 5, and if you see here, you have a 2D grid or 2D array where you have it going from 1 to 5 on the top row, and it just clockwise keeps counting up until you reach the last number, which is n times n, 25. And then again, another challenge input is 4, where you just print out this grid down here. So that's basically the problem that we're trying to solve. It's super straightforward. Given one number, print out a grid that's n by n, which follows this like fashion, right? So the hard part is trying to mimic that, or how do you kind of simulate that in a computer? So again, let's go ahead and define this problem on the whiteboard before we break it down with my solution. Okay, so in this problem, you're given an n, and using that n, you're supposed to build up an n by n matrix or grid. In this case, we'll just say n is equal to 3. So if n is provided and it's 3, we need to build a 3x3 grid, and then the goal is to print out a matrix which spirals in this fashion. So if you notice that the center number is just n squared, and your goal is to print out starting at 1, going in a clockwise manner until you reach the center. All right, so now that we understand the problem that we're trying to solve, let's try to work it out where n is equal to 3. So a few takeaways is if n is equal to 3, we know that we're going to keep putting values until we reach the final value of n squared, which is 9, right? So we know that in our code, we could just do some type of loop and loop until a variable, so for instance, x, is greater than 9, because 9 is the last element we're going to place. So that's one takeaway that we can kind of get from this problem. Another takeaway is we need to start in the top left corner. So if we were to represent the rows and the columns as integers, we know that the top left corner is going to be 0, 0. So we can go ahead and just place the first value, which is 1, in that top left corner. Now the next part that you kind of have to realize is you need to set some type of direction. So each iteration we're going to be moving in a certain direction, either to the right, down, left, or up. So in this case, we're going to represent that with a positive or negative 1 and using the variables d row or d column. So for example, if d row is equal to 1, that means we need to move in a down direction. Or if d row is 0, that means we don't move up or down. And instead, if d column was set to 1, that means we need to move in the positive right direction. So d row and d column are the variables we're going to use to kind of figure out the direction in which we're going to move, and then also when we get to certain spots, we're going to move the direction in a clockwise manner. And finally, row and column is the particular spot in the matrix that we're at that current iteration. So working through this, let's go ahead and we put the first value of 1 in row 0, column 0. And then we need to check to see if the direction we're about to move has an element or a slot that we can move to. So if we do row plus d row, which is 0, and then column plus d column, which makes column equal to 1, we say, is there an element here? Like, is this out of bounds? Or have we already put something there? And if so, we need to go ahead and change direction. But in this case, none of that is true. There is a blank slot there, so we can move in that direction. So we can just go ahead and increment the value of x to 2 and place that 2 in whatever row and column element that we're at, that current part of the iteration. All right, so now we just do that again, right? We check if we were to add d column to column and d row to row, would that put us in bounds? And in fact, it would give us an element that hasn't been seen yet. So we can go ahead and do that same operation where we increment x, we increment column by adding d column to it. So now we're at 0, 2, and we can put a 3 there. Now for this third iteration, or the next iteration, if we were to move to 0, 3, we'd be out of bounds, right? So we know that we need to move in a 90 degree clockwise fashion to go down now. So one thing to take away is to kind of switch directions, we can just swap the values of D row and D column, right? Because we need to go down positive 1, which means that D row will just become whatever D column is. And then D column will just become whatever D row was. And we can negate it. And I'll go over that in a second when we get down to going left. So again, we do the same process where we add a D row to row, which gives us a 1 here. We go ahead and increment X. We're at 1, 2. Place the value. Increment X. We're at 2, 2. Again, place the value. And then if we were to move in that same direction one more time, we'd go out of bounds, which means we need to do that same operation where we switch these. So D row will become 0, which will become the value of whatever D column was. D column is going to be equal to what D row was, which was 1, but then negate it, which allows us to go left. So then in this case, when we add D column to column, this will become 1, which puts us at 6. Same process. This becomes 0. This becomes 7. And again, if we were to move in the negative D direction, we go out of bounds, so we need to swap these again. So 0 becomes negative 1. Negative 1 will become 0. Which, if you look at this, that means that we're going to be going up again. We can increment the 7 here to an 8. Add D row to row to make this a 1 instead of 2. And now we check if the next element we're going to go to is already existing. We again just do the whole swapping mechanism. So this will become positive 1. This will become a 0. Increment this to a 9. And add D column to column. So we're left with 1, 1. And we built up our grid. And the same process will work for bigger and bigger grids, as long as you just keep checking if you're about to go out of bounds or if you're about to go to a slot that already has a value. We just go ahead and swap D row and D column and negate D column, add it to row and column, place the value, and then increment X by 1. All right, so that's the solution on the whiteboard. Let's go ahead and implement this in JavaScript. All right, so to start off, let's go ahead and create a function called createGrid, which is going to take one parameter called in, which is going to be how big our in by in ascension grid should be. And then I'll go ahead and say const grid is equal to an empty array, and then return that down here. And this will be the array or grid that we're trying to build up. And then down here, I'll go ahead and say console log create a grid of 5, so we can kind of work towards a solution using in of 5. So the first step is we need to create a in by in blank grid or array, which I found this little implementation on Stack Overflow, which can be used for building up a in by in grid. And all this is doing is creating a grid that's in, and then for each element inside there, putting another array, which is length of in. So now that we have a blank 2x2 or in by in grid, we can go ahead and start declaring those variables like we used on the whiteboard example. So starting off, I can say let number is equal to 1, which is going to be the first number that we start off, and it's also the x that we used in the whiteboard. We can say let row is equal to 0, let column is equal to 0, which are going to be used for representing the exact element location that we're at in the grid. We can say let d row is equal to 0, and let d column is equal to 1, which is going to be the initial direction, which will be in the right direction, or going from left to right, that we need to traverse the grid in. So we've declared all of our kind of starting initial variables that we're going to use for the iteration. The next step is we need to loop X amount of times until we reached n times n as our final number. So if you remember, we need to go until number is less than or equal to n times n. So in the 3x3 example, this will go until we reached 10, or 1 more than 9. So that should make sense as to, you know, the while loop we're doing and why we have to loop 2 n times n. The next step is we need to place our current number inside the grid at the current location that we're at. So if we say grid of row column is equal to number, that'll place a 1 in the top left spot. And then we need to, again, increment number by 1. So I'll go ahead and say number plus plus here. And like we talked about, after we place a number, we need to check if the next location we're going to is out of bounds. So I can say if column plus d column is equal to n, which means are we going out of bounds on the right side of the grid? I can say if row plus d row is equal to n, meaning are we about to go out of bounds on the bottom of the grid? And I can say if column plus d column is equal to negative 1, that's checking if we're about to go out of bounds on the left side of the grid. And then finally, we can say if we've already seen the location that we're about to go to, so grid of row plus d row, and then column of column plus d column, if that's already defined, this is where we need to do our whole swapping logic, or, you know, turn by 90 degrees clockwise. So to do that, what we can do is just declare a temp value and set it equal to d row. We can set d column equal to d row. Set d column equal to the temp of d row. And then d row is going to be equal to d column. So the exact logic that we did over there, we just set the row equal to d column. We set d column equal to d row negated. But we need to use this kind of temp variable to keep track of it, because we're going to override it on line 17. So we need to bring in another constant called temp so we don't overwrite. And then lastly, we just need to increment row by the direction of the row that we're trying to go. So row plus equals d row, which will increment our row in the correct direction. And then same thing with column. We can just say column plus equal d column, which will increment column in the correct direction. So that basically wraps up implementing the solution that we did on the whiteboard in JavaScript. You see here at the bottom of the console log, it's printing out the correct row where it's all spiraling in a clockwise fashion from 1 to n times n. So if you notice, it ends at 25, and the n that we started with was 5, so 5 times 5 is 25. Yeah, so hopefully this one wasn't too hard. If you have your own solution or you have any questions, feel free to paste something in the comment section below. Just a heads up, the next one I'm going to talk about is called Talking Clock, and that is number 321, and I'll put a link to it in the bottom of the description of this video. So if you want to work on that now, and then in a couple days, I'm going to post my solution to that problem. So just a heads up. And again, be sure to like and subscribe to Free Code Camp and this video if you thought this was a good tutorial. All right, stay tuned for the next video. Thanks for watching.